Welcome, we'll talk about the 6th chapter for class 10th NCERT. Here we'll focus on the political parties. Now coming on to the very first issue, why are political parties important? So political parties are basically vehicles of federal change or federal sharing. So they act as power sharing groups. They act as a negotiator between the common man and the political setup or the government, we could say. Now when we talk about a political party, it's definitely required because 100 years back, if we look on to the phenomena, we had only few political parties, and now there are only few nations which do not have political parties. So that's the kind of change that has come over during the period of 100 years. And it's definitely there are a group of people who keep on blaming the various political parties for not achieving the standards. But on the other hand, these political parties are important because they ultimately represent people or give the opinion of the people in front of the government. So they basically bring in laws, bring in amendments, or they have a strong opposition, and that opposition pressurizes the party that's ruling to work on certain issues. So some of the important points that we talk about are: political parties are definitely a group of people who come together to contest the elections with the same ideology or a same mindset, we could say. They try to persuade people why their party is good and why you should follow a certain party or a specific party. They aim to win the popular support. Now what would happen if I stand as an individual candidate? I can win an election, but when it comes to ultimately representation in the parliament or the state legislature, one person cannot represent. So each one, if they are standing as an independent candidate, will not be able to express themselves. So what would happen is there would be a kind of political division in the society, and formation of these political parties liberalizes the issue or makes this much more easier to express their opinion or bring out a certain change. So these parties, what are their main functions? First of all, contesting the elections, forming various programs and policies for the betterment of the nation, making decisive roles or important decisions for amendment of the law or bringing in a new law, forming and running the government. The next is those who lose take part in the opposition. So a strong opposition would definitely have a pressure on the ruling party, and therefore there could not be undue changes that could be made in the parliament. Again, an idea is to shape a good public opinion and provide access to the government machinery and welfare schemes. So those are some of the major functions why political parties are important and they are required in the country. The next is, when we talk about the requirement of the political party, the few things that we take into account are, as we said, the independent candidates, even if they win, they cannot have their opinion presented in the government, because for that you need a kind of majority support, and that could be possible only if you are a part of certain political party. To support the government to make policies or bring in any kind of change, you must have a kind of representation, and that representation is brought about by political party. Now, political parties could be of different types. There could be one party system where there is a single democratic party that exists, or a single party that exists and rules the country. There could be only two major parties that appear. For example, in US, and you have United Kingdom. So in US you have Democrats and Republicans. So just two major parties, and then you have independent candidates that stand. However, India follows a multi-party system. When we talk about a multi-party system, a basic advantage is you try or you provide a competing base for the political parties. And sometimes what happens is, let's say there are five political parties A, B, C and D. Out of that you have total 50 seats. Now if party A gets 30 seats, then you have a kind of absolute majority, and this party A would form the government. In another case, you have 5, 10, 10, 15 and 5 seats for the different parties that are allocated. What would happen is some of the parties would come together to form a coalition government, and that is what is commonly seen when you have a multi-party system. So you have the coalition government that takes place. In India, there have been three major alliances in 2004. So NDA, or the National Democratic Alliance, United Progressive Alliance and the Left Front were three of those. Now when the party evolves, It evolves with a long history it has. So each party has its own ideology. There was one of the study that was done recently on the state of political parties. The study revealed that political parties are the least trusted institutions in the world. However, the participation in political parties in India is much higher as compared to other nations. The proportion of people who are member of national parties or political parties have increased over the time. People do not enjoy much trust in the political organizations, and the proportion of people who are feeling themselves closely knitted or tied to a political group has increased over the time. So that's just one of the findings based on the survey. Now coming on to the types of political party. In India, we have predominantly two types of parties, the national party and the state party. Now the criteria to become a national party and a state party are different. So we'll understand that in a while. However, each national party must register with the Election Commission of India. On registering, they would receive special facilities. They would have a kind of symbol that could be used by the official members only, which are recognized, and therefore recognition of a political party is very, very important. So the criteria to be recognized is very simple. 6% of the total votes to the legislative assemblies in at least two of the states would make a state party, and in at least four of the Lok Sabha states would make a national party, and along with that you would have a four seats in Lok Sabha. So that's a kind of summary. We would have a detailed criteria here. So for being a national party, a detailed criteria is getting a recognition as a state party in at least four of the states. In the general elections, the party must poll 6% of the votes in four of the states and win four Lok Sabha seats at least. Along with that, the party should win 2% of the seats in Lok Sabha. As of 2011, there were 11 seats from at least three different states. So if all these criteria are fulfilled, we say the party is considered a national party. The NCERT gives 6 as national party. However, as of 2018, we have 7 national parties that are present. The first is the Indian National Congress. This is the oldest party, established in 1885. The idea is basically secularism, welfare of the weaker section, the minority, and supporting the economic reforms. Under Jawaharlal Nehru, huge developments were brought about under the Indian National Congress. Bhartiya Janata Party or BJP is the next party, founded in 1980, a kind of recent party with the original name as Bhartiya Jan Sangh. The ideologies are territorial integration of Jammu Kashmir with India, banning the religious conversions, uniform civil code, and so those are some of the major ideas that are laid under Bhartiya Janata Party or BJP. The next is All India Trinamool Congress, founded in 1998, very recently by Mamata Banerjee, with the party symbol as flower and glass. Bahujan Samaj Party, formed by Kanshi Ram in 1984 after formation of BJP. The idea was to help the Bahujan Samaj, or the section which includes the Dalit, Adivasi, OBC or religious minorities. The next is CPIM. Now CPIM separated from CPI. So CPI was founded in 1925. Later on CPIM broke from this party and you had the formation in 1964. CPIM is Marxist and believes in the Marxist and Leninist philosophy. So socialism, secularism and democracy are the key points. It is mainly seen in West Bengal, Kerala and Tripura, and it supports the poor, factory farmers, factory workers and laborers. The CPI, that's the Communist Party of India, is opposed to the forces of communalism, and this splitted into CPIM in 1964 that we have already seen. CPI is present mainly in Kerala, West Bengal, Punjab, Andhra Pradesh and Tamil Nadu. The next important party is Nationalist Congress Party, present in Maharashtra, Meghalaya, Manipur and Assam. It believes in democracy, Gandhian secularism, social justice and federalism. So the key aspects of each party are important, and it has been founded in 1999. Now coming on to the state party, the criteria is the party should win minimum 3% of the total seats and minimum 3 seats in state legislature, should win at least 1 seat in Lok Sabha for every 25 seats, or should secure 6% of the valid votes in an election 2 Lok Sabha State Assembly and win at least 1 Lok Sabha seat and 2 Legislative Assembly seats. Finally, a recognition of state party is considered if it secures 8% of or more of the total valid votes polled in the state. Some of the common state parties are Sikkim Democratic Front, Mizo Nationalist Front and Biju Janata Dal Party. Now here you have a map of India with different state parties ruling into the different states. So that's very, very important. We have around 750 political parties that have been recognized. Now what are the challenges to the political parties? Sometimes people express dissatisfaction based on the work that the political party has been doing. There is lack of internal democracy. So the concentration of power comes in the hand of only few of the people. As a result, the party cannot maintain a kind of equity or equality among its members. The next is dynasty succession. So the son and the grandsons from the same party join the party. Money and muscle power again plays an important role in political party. Then sometimes these parties do not offer a kind of meaningful choices. For example, in Britain you have Labour Party and Conservative Party with a very meager difference between the ideologies of two, and it's mainly on the fundamental aspects that they agree, but some differences on the policy implementation that could be seen. Now when we talk about reforming a political party, defection is a major thing. So under defection what happens is you win election from a certain party, then for money you switch on to another party. So you have the Anti-Defection Law Act that came into being. So constitution amended the law to prevent MPs and MLAs from changing their parties. So that was the anti-defection. Then you had the law to regulate the internal affairs or the internal matters of the political party that's required, making it mandatory for 1/3 of the women to participate in the political parties, providing state funding of the elections. So all these are important. However, in certain cases, if there are over-regulations, it can definitely be harmful, because when there are over-regulations, it would force the parties to find alternate ways to cheat. It would also, the parties would not agree with the law that are being formed, and ultimately they are the one who would be passing the law, so they won't pass the law. So therefore, over-regulation can be harmful. So whatever they don't like or they are not convinced with would not be ultimately passed. So political parties can improve if those who want to join it wholeheartedly, and it basically depends on the degree of public participation, the trust and the level of transparency or accountability or responsibility among the citizens or the people who are joining the political parties. So it's good to have a better politics rather than a bad political party. So those are the things that have been discussed and covered in this chapter. We'll be covering the last two chapters for the political science, and then we'll switch to history for class 10. So stay tuned for further updates. Have a very good day ahead.